Saunders is back in South Africa and has lived here for the last few years. Before, he lived and worked in London for 35 years. He holds degrees from Rhodes University and Oxford University, and as well as a diploma in fine and decorative arts. Edward is an international lecturer in the history of art and architecture. He has worked in England for organizations such as the National Trust, the National Art Collections Fund, the National Association of Fine and Decorative Arts Societies, and the Christie's Fine Arts Course. He has been a frequent lecturer on tours and cruises throughout Europe for Swan Hellenic and on tours for NADFAS. Edward has also undertaken several lecture tours for the Australian Decorative and Fine Arts Society. Please give him a warm welcome.
Right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'll just switch the lights down a bit, if I can.
They're meant to
go down. Is that all right? More. Yeah. Sorry, you do it. Can you hear at the back? Can you hear at the back? No. Oh. It's the most it'll go, I'm afraid. I'll try and speak as loud as possible. It's the most it'll go. Sorry? It's fuzzy in the front. I can't help with that, Julie. Anyway, I'll begin with the first. No, that's fine. Right, so we'll begin with the first slide, ladies and gentlemen. There is a map of the Czech Republic. The Republic only was formed in 1994 with the breakup of Czechoslovakia. It was a very amicable breakup, if you remember. And Prague is now the capital of the Czech Republic. The map on the top right-hand side shows the regions of the Czech Republic. There's Bohemia, and there's Moravia, and there's Silesia. And the three of them form the Czech Republic. And the map shows the red background is Bohemia, the blue is Moravia, and the yellow is Silesia. Through Prague runs the river Vltava, and then before it reaches the German border, it joins with the Elbe, and the Elbe then flows north into Germany through Dresden and then on its way further north still. The Czech Republic is part of the European Union, as are all the countries surrounding it, Germany, Poland, Slovakia, and Austria. And through the centuries, Prague has miraculously, has survived war damage. There has been damage through the centuries, there has been looting, but it's never ever been on the scale that virtually every other European country has suffered. So that is why Prague and actually other cities in the Czech Republic are so wonderful historically, and they have these amazing buildings. Prague is absolutely jam-packed full of the most extraordinary architecture from through the centuries, going from the 1300s through to the 21st century. So let's just begin with a view of the River Vltava. The River Vltava, which flows north, as I say, into Germany. And in the center there is the Charles Bridge, which we shall discuss later. On the left-hand side are the some of the many, many steeples and spires and domes of the old town. In the mid-distance, there's a rather large squat dome there, which is the National Theatre. And the National Theatre was opened in the late 19th century for the production and the display of Czech music, Czech theatre, and so on. I'll revert to that in a moment. Then in the far distant horizon on the left, you can see what in fact are a pair of steeples, which is part of a neo-Gothic church. It's not a very exciting church, but I pointed out to you because the river will flow through Prague and turn towards the left and will flow past the promontory on which that building in the distance is situated. The building is in the area called Visharad. And Visharad is this promontory on which the very earliest peoples, going way back into the dim distant past, the very earliest peoples settled on this promontory before the construction of Prague proper. Today it's a park, much visited by the locals. You can get there quite easily, in fact, if you're a visitor and you want to go there by metro. And it's got a variety of buildings, mainly of the 19th century. In addition, there's a big cemetery there, which is where all the great and the good of the Czech Republic are buried, like Dvořák, like the artist Mucha, like many of the great politicians and so on. Now, in the promontory are a variety of styles and buildings, and there is, amongst the buildings, a little round church. Round churches have nothing specifically to do with the Czech Republic. A round church is to do with the fact that it's an early Christian place of worship. They don't normally date from after about 1000. And you can find round churches in France, in Italy, in England, and elsewhere. But you'll see the significance of that in a moment. There is a sculpture park in the area of Visharad, and there, amongst the statues is this particular one on the right. It's obviously a girl standing up waving in to the distance and a chap sitting down. I've learned how I think I should pronounce these words in Czech, these names and so on. I've done it from the internet, so if there's any Czech speaker and you're horrified by my accent, I apologize, but at least I've tried. And the two of them are Šemišl and Libuše. And the story is, and it's a complete legend, it's not true, but it's a story, and the Czechs love legends. Every building, every statue has some legend associated with it. And the legend is that the lady standing up is Libuše, and she was the daughter of a chieftain who lived on this promontory. And she then succeeded her father, whose name was Krok, K-R-O-K, and she was a very good ruler, but the chieftains went to her, the various dignitaries went to her and said, look, it's all very well, you're a great ruler, but you need to get married, hoping that she'll choose one of them, of course. And so she goes into the fields one day. She has these visions. She's a woman who's got sort of a far sight and so on, a second sight. And so she went into the fields and she wandered around and she saw a chap ploughing the field. And she thought, well, he's much better than those hoary old men who tried to marry me off to me. And so she chooses the ploughman. And so the ploughman and Libuše get married. And in fact, the first dynasty of Prague, the first ruler, the first dukes of Moravia, and the first dukes of Bohemia are of the Šemišl dynasty. And so it's named after this mythical chap. It's all mythical. Anyway, there is a painting again, making an imaginary scene. She's standing there with her arm out. She's pointing towards this vision she has of the city that will arise in the future. And so the artist here has shown this vision in a sort of hazy distance of a background. And in fact, you can see the exact same in a photograph down below. There's St Vitus Cathedral. There's the building surrounding St Vitus, which is the castle district. And the view is from the area where I mentioned those two towers of the Neo-Gothic cathedral. So Libuše is predicting the future, and she says in one of her predictions, I see a great city which will arise from the mists or whatever, and it is the city of Prague. Now, she's very much part and parcel of the whole sort of ethos of the city, and everyone knows her name, and she in fact was perpetuated in an opera that was composed by Smetana, just at the end of his life, in fact. It was composed for the opening of the National Theatre, the building I showed you with its large dome. And so this, the opera is sometimes performed. The Metropolitan Opera in New York has performed it. And it has, in fact, the most fantastic fanfare when Libuše obviously comes in to be married to her ploughman. And so I'll play you this amazing fanfare, which is by Smetana. Smetana, the great composer of the turn of the century, the late 19th, early 20th century. And there you can hear this. I think you can. There you are. it's quite some fanfare, I think, and I'm going to ask Summer School to play it next year when I appear for my 29th time. So, from the distant legends to an actual historical figure of St. Wenceslas. You all know him as good King Wenceslas, but he never was a king. Wenceslas was the son of the Duke at the time. This is the early 900s, just at the beginnings of the emergence of Prague and the Czech nation. And he succeeds his father, but at the age of 13. So he's brought up by his grandmother, St. Ludmilla, who converts him to Christianity, because it reminds us that in the early 900s, the Slavs in general, and the Czechs in particular, had just been converted to Christianity. So there was still a conflict between the pagan religion before Christianity and the emerging new faith. And St. Wenceslas, in fact, obviously embraces Christianity, and he founds a rotunda. He builds a round church and consecrates it to St. Vitus, and we'll discuss that in a moment. Then, in fact, his brother, his nasty younger brother, who is a pagan, has St. Wenceslas murdered. And of course, then he takes over the power. But Wenceslas, because of his murder, becomes very popular amongst the emerging Christian peoples of Central Europe. And very soon thereafter, he's canonized. And today, he is the patron saint of Bohemia, not of the Czech Republic, of Bohemia, one of the four to three regions. And he's very evident. He's, again, somebody that everyone sort of talks about. There's Wenceslas bars, and there's Wenceslas chocolate, or whatever else. And there is thought to be what could have been the early Christian rotunda that he builds when he's in power as the Duke. It is dedicated, most confusingly, to a saint from, it's getting worse and worse, dedicated to a saint from Sicily. And the reason for that is that any ruler in the Middle Ages longed to have some relic. It's getting worse. Can you do something? Well, I'll try, but it doesn't miss. I'll try. We're going to try a lapel mic, but I've got to dress up now. I'll go on talking because there's so much to talk about. St. Vitus there was a relic of St. Vitus. And as I say, any ruler, no, I can't, it's too much noise. Can you hear? If you shut up, can you hear? Yes. Thank you. All right. Now we'll go on from there. As I say, any ruler of the Middle Ages obviously longed to have relics. I mean, the King of France had the crown of thorns. And so Wenceslas was thrilled to get this relic of St. Vitus, although it came from Sicily, from the Emperor Henry I, who was the German emperor. And therefore he named the cathedral, which still survives, after a Sicilian saint, which is actually rather confusing. But anyway, that is the background to it. Now, this is a painting on the right-hand side of St. Vitus, suffering his martyrdom, and apart from being boiled in a pot, as you see there in this rather gruesome German painting, he also was made to walk on coals, which was why you get the name St. Vitus's Dance. There is the chapel of St. Wenceslas, which is supposedly it's part of St. Vitus Cathedral today, and it is where it is on top of where it is thought the original rotunda was placed. It's a magnificent building. You're not allowed into it. It's too small for the huge crush of people now visiting Prague. But it does contain the relics of St. Wenceslas, and it has a vast range of frescoes from later centuries. But it's begun in the 13th or 40s, and we'll discuss that tomorrow. not tomorrow, later on. sorry, I've been thrown by that mic. I'll recover in a minute. I'll go back there. The chapel is St. Wenceslas's chapel, and there is in existence what is the earliest, one of the earliest Czech hymns, which is dedicated to St. Wenceslas, because he's a tremendously important figure. And in this hymn, they pray that the people pray to St. Wenceslas to protect them and to care for them and to look after them and so on, which they still feel that he should do or wants to, they want him to do today. So I'll play one verse of this for you. It is the St. Wenceslas. So that's the first verse of that hymn, which is rather beautiful, and it is dates from the 1300s. So you've all heard of Wenceslas Square. It's also, I think, the one thing one knows about, even if you've never been to Prague. It's not actually a square, it's an avenue, but at the top of the square, as we call it, is a large 19th century building, which is a natural history museum. You can see that in number one, top left. The photograph showing Prague in sort of earlier peaceful times at the beginning of the 1900s. Then, of course, it has witnessed all sorts of famous and tragic events in Wenceslas Square. And, of course, in August 1968, the Russian tanks rolled into Prague and entered Wenceslas Square. There were demonstrations. A lot of the demonstrators were shot. The Russians, of course, coming into Prague entering the Czech Republic to overthrow the ruler of the time, the leader of the time, whose name, if you remember, was Alexander Dubček. And so then they were, this was the time after that, that the Czechs were very, very badly oppressed by the Russians. And then 21 years later, a completely different event took place in number three, where again, if you remember, November 1989, hundreds and thousands of people every night in freezing cold November nights and days would assemble in Wenceslas Square silently or peacefully endeavoring to overthrow the communist regime, which in fact they did. It's called the Velvet Revolution. I say it was freezing cold in November because Prague has a Central European climate. It's very humid and hot in summer, and it's very, very cold in winter. So you have to manage to sort of weave your way between the two extremes if you want to go there. And then on number four is Wenceslas Square today. And it's a big avenue. It's got all sorts of nice shops and coffee bars and things in it. Marks and Spencer's is there if you're interested. And from there, we move on to another of the great figures, which brings us more into the modern, sort of more contemporary era, Emperor Charles IV. The emperor, in fact, did more to Prague than I think anybody else. He didn't, I think, ever look like the statue on the left. That is a 19th century memorial to him or monument to him. In fact, I think he was a short man. And I think he wasn't a very prepossessing looking man, but in fact he had an enormous dynamism. He was born in Prague, Charles IV. His father was John of Luxembourg, the King of Bohemia, who dies at the Battle of Crecy. Battle of Crecy, of course, was one of the battles of the Hundred Years' War, a battle that the English won over the French. Then, with his death of his father, Charles IV becomes the King of the Romans and then finally the Holy Roman Emperor. And because, of course, he knew Prague, he actually was fluent in six languages and spoke Czech, of course, so that he moves his capital to Prague. And this, of course, is vital to the development of Prague, because now Prague is the center of a huge empire, the Holy Roman Empire. and he initiates what is known as the Golden Age of Bohemia. He rebuilds St Vitus, which we'll look at in a moment. He founds the Charles Cathedral, and it's still at the Charles University, and it still survives today. He starts the construction of the Charles Bridge, which after 700 years still stands, which is quite amazing. And he establishes what is the new town. It's not actually all that interesting an area today, but it must remind us that this far-sighted man was laying out a planned city environment for the first time since the Roman world. So it was important. And then eventually he dies and is buried in St. Vitus Cathedral. St. Vitus Cathedral looks all of a piece. It looks as if it was built in the course of, say, 20 years, instead of which it's built in the course of about 600 years. It takes a very long time to be built. But Charles IV begins the church as we know it today. And we'll see how it developed in a moment. In the foreground, you can see this rather boring range of buildings. They're largely 18th century. They were built for the Empress Marie Theresia, and they are part of the royal palace. Today, they're presidential and prime ministerial offices and whatever. But St. Vitus is one of the great cathedrals of the world, and it has this magnificent interior. Where the sunlight is pouring through into the east end in the chancel, that is the beginnings of the cathedral as it is today. It was begun from 1344 at the command of Charles IV. And where the statue is on the right-hand side, where I pointed the cursor, it is behind that is the Wenceslas Chapel, the chapel I showed you just now. And then as you come towards the west end, towards the photograph, you can see these columns, these bunches of columns, these clusters of columns, which of course are 19th and 20th century. But what is so extraordinary is it's all of a piece, and it doesn't seem as if there's any sort of disjuncture there. And what you find most interestingly is that here is a paper model of Prague. It's huge. It's about half the size of this room. It's absolutely enormous. And it was one man's sort of chef d'oeuvre. It's a man called Antonín Lungvile. And he creates all this out of paper, or I think probably hard sort of cardboard paper, in between 1820s and 1830s. And it's the most extraordinary record. The whole city is represented from that era in this tiny model, these tiny little buildings, rather, in this huge conglomeration. Now, you can see there from the paper model, which, by the way, is in a very interesting museum, the City of Prague Museum. It's quite easy to get to. It's on the metro or tram lines, transport. There you can see it's a gap in the middle there. The cathedral ends with the bell tower. So there is the chancel, the east end built for Charles IV, and then it still awaits its reconstruction, as it does in that lower left-hand photograph, where again there's nothing there. And now in a modern photograph, you can see the cathedral ending with the west end. It ends in about 1920, 25, with some marvelous doors, modern bronze doors. So it's had a sort of checkered and rather complex development. But it survives intact, it survives very much as a great monument. Now, in contrast, the castle that Charles builds outside Prague, much visited and very popular today, is Karlstein, named after Charles, of course. And it looks like anyone's image, I think, of a castle. It's turreted and defensive and very sort of forbidding, with this enormous tower rising above through it. And the tower obviously is defensive. It looks very much a sort of keep. And it was in this tower that Charles placed all the important aspects of his position and his power, the coronation regalia, the crown of Bohemia, the relics, other relics that he had assembled, and so on. And so it was a sort of treasure trove there inside. And one of the rooms inside that tower is the Chapel of the Holy Cross. And this is incredibly interesting and important because it's about 1340s, 1350s, and it's one of these rare examples of
in this instance, a place of worship, but they normally are, that in fact survives intact from the time it was created. It hasn't changed. If he came back now, Charles IV would recognize it. And it is rather like, it's been compared to the Scroveni Chapel, which is in the northern town of Italy in Padua, the Scroveni Chapel, painted about two decades before this, not long before, by Giotto. And it's one of these, again, absolutely epoch-making moments that you can see exactly what was going on at that time. And the paintings on the walls, all painted by the one man, and survive as they were placed in the 1300s. And they're all are of saints and religious scenes, of course. And you can see here the creator of those paintings. There were 128 of them, Master Theodoric. We don't know much about him. We think he was of German origin. He certainly registered in the Painters Guild in 1345. And his art is very distinctive. It's rather naive, big faces. They're rather squashed into their picture frames. And they always look rather benign, these rather blank sort of expressions. There you can see the three of the four evangelists. There's Matthew with his angel, Mark with his lion, Luke with his bull, and they're all whispering into the ear of the respective writer of the Gospels, telling them what to do, you see. I love the lion in the middle, don't you? He's sort of nuzzling next to St. Mark. There is St. Catherine with her wheel, of course, down below. There is St. Jerome, one of the fathers of the Western Church. You can see he's sort of bulging out of his frame. It's all sort of extending over the frame. And the bottom right is Elizabeth of Hungary. She used to feed the poor, and there she's feeding baked beans to someone in the corner there. It takes us into another world. It takes us into this world of medieval mysticism, this world of fantasy. And in that such a chapel as I've just shown you, the Chapel of the Holy Cross, you could sort of imagine, as it would be very much contemporary at the time, you can imagine, I can only play a tiny bit of this, but you can imagine a Gregorian chant. That gives you a sort of idea of the sort of mysticism and magic of these wonderful interiors that survive. So let's move on to the Charles Bridge, which was constructed, as I say, at the same time as the beginnings of the cathedral, 1340s. And it is the most extraordinary structure because you can see it below. And it survives floods, damage, destruction, war, invasion, and it still stands happily across what is a very fast flowing river, the Vltava. The upper illustration shows the position of the buildings we're discussing. That is St. Vitus on the left-hand side. Then below St. Vitus is what is known as the Lesser Town, where the artisans, where the court officials and so on and so forth lived in attendance to the ruler in the castle district. And then the Lesser Town leads you to the bridge, the Charles Bridge, crossing into what is the Old Town. And below, as I say, in the lesser town, in the lower illustration, you can see one of the great churches I'll come on to later, St. Nicholas of the Lesser Town, and St. Vitus Cathedral again, Charles Bridge, and then one of the great noble families of the Czech lands is the Lobkowitz family, the Lobkowitz families, which I'll show you briefly again after we've had a break. So you're on the Charles Bridge here. You can see at the top left hand is the early morning, and then the bottom is taken in the winter snow. I took the one at the top, not the one at the bottom. I had been in Prague when it was cold. In fact, I was there when it was minus 16, which wasn't too much fun. But what you see in this photograph above is the classic shot of the two towers, which are the access to the bridge from the lesser town. And the two towers frame what is the dome and the bell tower of St. Nicholas in the lesser town. And there's the cathedral behind. On the bridge stand these 30 statues. They are 3 centuries after the bridge was built. They're much, much later. They're 17th century, the statues, or 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries, the statues. So there you see the view of the lesser tower, and the smaller tower is from the earlier bridge. There was an earlier bridge crossing the Vltava, and then that tower survives as a remnant of that. The bigger tower is from the time of the construction under Charles IV. So then if you turn your back to that view and look the other direction across down the bridge towards what is the old town, so you're crossing the river now, and there you can see the Nazis crossing the bridge, and you can actually make out tram lines. They also had trams running across the bridge at one stage, can you think of it? And then there are these views in the mist and in summer and so on, in the light. And then you can see in each of them the tower that leads you through, you walk under that tower, through that tower, to the old town beyond. The old town, which is a treasure trove of history and architecture. And there, if you were in a drone, for instance, and you were hovering a sort of a couple of feet above the ground, you'd get this view. You get this view, and which is why Prague is called the City of 100 Spires, because it has this absolute multiplicity of domes and towers and monuments and whatever church buildings in its midst. And they survive so intact. And the old town is really almost a sort of combination. It's like an architectural museum almost. So when you get into the old town, you walk through these little windy streets. They're all pedestrian, or largely pedestrian today. Then you get into what is the old town square. And you're looking down there upon buildings that go through 5 or 6 centuries. And they all still just stand there in higgledy-piggledy mass. The building on the left, this prominent, balanced, very grand, magnificent structure of the 18th century, is called the Galtskinsky Palace. It's now, in fact, a series of sort of display rooms and museums and things. Next to it, next to the 18th century palace, is in fact an earlier, much earlier building. It's called At the Stone Bell. All buildings were given names then. And it probably was larger originally, but it is thought to be the only surviving example in the world of a medieval palace from the 1300s. And it's in that building that probably Charles IV himself was born. So it is extraordinary that it just sits there still. That's sort of 700 years ago, almost exactly. behind that is the Tin Church, T-Y-N. The tin means the ramparts or ditch. So it was obviously behind that was the sort of the area of a ditch running round of the town. It's the image of anyone's idea of a sort of fancy fairy tale structure with these pinnacles and crockets and so on stabbing the sky. It's beautifully a beautiful interior which you can go into today. In front of that, in front of the Tin Church, of merchants' houses of varying dates, but they largely are from the sort of 1700s, 1700s. So all that just in one sort of conglomeration, all of it surviving, all of it with different aspects of the history of the city and so on. And within the square, there also is the town hall. There you can see the Tin Church again, T-Y-N as I say. And there's the town hall tower. on the tower is this famous astronomical clock. And it is hugely popular. It strikes on the hour, it works, of course, and it rings, the bells ring and figures move and whatever on the hour, every hour. And it is inevitably a Swiss mechanism. It was created in the 1400s, and it's not unique. There are other these marvelous clocks in, I know of one in Munich, for instance, there's another in Bern. There are lots of them dotted around Europe, but this is particularly popular. And as the hour approaches, it feels as if the people watching that about the half the population of the world. It's absolutely jam-packed with people. Unbelievable, unbelievable. And there, at the lower level, the figures don't move. That's the signs of the zodiac. You can see that in detail. But the upper level, they do move. And there are four figures. One is Vanity. He holds a mirror. Then next to him is the miser, holding his money bags. On the other side, on the right-hand side, is a skeleton who's bringing a bell, reminding us that we are going to be called. Next to that is the Turk. And that's sort of rather interesting, because the Turk is obviously the bogeyman. The Turk equals Islam. And what has changed? Not very much. And then the windows at the top open, and they show the 12 apostles come and bow to you as the hour approaches. And on top of that, is still in the middle, is a golden cockerel, and he crows. So I've got a very, very noisy recording, because with half the world there at the hour, it is rather noisy. So I'll play with this recording. I think we're all children at heart. It's rather fun, really. Now, in the old square again, and there's the Gotskinsky 18th century palace I mentioned, is in the center the monument to Jan Hus. Jan Hus, who's the great Protestant reformer, who led a revolution, basically, in the Czech lands in the early 15th century. And it's the Jan Hus monument, which was created early in the 1900s. It's 1915, and I think it's the most fantastic monument. With this figure sort of rising, it's almost as if he's rising from the mist or rising from the waves. He's this huge figure of the reformer Jan Hus. And beneath him, in rather sort of strange lettering, is love each other and wish the truth to everyone, which is a rather nice sentiment. Behind him, by the way, because I'll show you a detail in a moment, behind him to the right is a 19th century building. It was originally a commercial building. It was an office for fire insurance, because in the next slide you'll see there's a fireman on the roof there. So he's just a statue. He's not working. And there is Jan Hus. Jan Hus, who came from a very poor background. He was born in a town called Husinek, which is why he takes the name Hus. He was obviously a very clever man. He went to the Charles University. He studies theology, as anyone would then, and he becomes the rector of the university. But he was incensed by the injustices of the church. And this is 100 years before the Reformation in England, don't forget, 100 years before Luther. And so he's a very early protester against the Catholic Church. And he's influenced by the writings of John Wycliffe from Scotland, and who also preaches against the corruption in the church. In 1410, he's excommunicated, but continues to preach in Prague, in a building I'll show you in a minute. And then in 1415, he's invited to attend the Council of Constance. This was a papal conference at which the Pope was the present. Lake Constance, of course, is in southern Germany, between Germany and Switzerland, in the center of Europe. And despite being invited and given a safe conduct, he actually was imprisoned and was burnt at the stake at Lake Constance. So that seemingly, at the time, they obviously thought this would be the end of the Troubles. Of course, it was only the beginning of the Troubles. Then his death precipitated the most enormous uprising in the Czech lands, and there was continuous fighting, what are called the Hussite Wars, throughout the 1400s, until there was finally a peace declared in 1485, when it gave tolerance to both sides, tolerance to the Protestants and the Catholics in the Czech lands, for about 100 years. There's a chapel which is recently reconstructed, but it is the Bethlehem Chapel where he used to preach, and he would get huge congregations to listen to his preachings. But there again, on the right-hand side, is the illustration from a contemporary codex, which is showing him being burnt at the stake. He's wearing a huge sort of dunce's cap on his head, and the priesthood and the nobility watching this event. So it was something that precipitated an enormous rebellion in the Czech lands, which then led eventually to the 30 years War, which we'll see later. And there is this hymn. What I find rather extraordinary about that is that huge congregation all know the words of this song. They didn't have song sheets or anything. They liked to sing a national anthem to them. So it still shows, even today, that there's a huge support for this very fundamental Hussite faith. And although statistically, the Czechs are now atheistic country, but there obviously are pockets of support both for the Catholics on the one side and the Protestants on the other. But apparently, when this song was sung, and the rebellion that took place after Hus's death was led by a man called Jan Žižka, who was this amazing commander. And it was a peasant army. They were largely the people from the land and the countryside who supported this movement, as opposed to the grand people who supported Catholicism. And when the Hussite army would move, singing this song, towards a village to attack it and so on, they would generally give in before the battle was fought, because they were so frightened just to hear this hymn. So it was... that's the story that's told anyway, but it's something that is again very central to the whole spirit of the Czech Republic. So there you can see the various districts of Prague. That is the new town, which, as I say, is not all that interesting historically or architecturally today, although there are certain buildings within it. But that is the town laid out by, well, the area here laid out by Charles IV. There is on the left-hand side is the lesser town, which descends down towards the Charles Bridge. That's the Charles Bridge there. So this is the sort of lesser town, above which is the castle district, Hradčany, with St Vitus. And then the old town is here, on the sort of center of the map. with, of course, again, there was a Jewish quarter, Josefov, which was towards the river Vltava. It was originally walled. The Jews in the Czech Republic settled at a very early stage, in the sort of 1100s. There were periods when there was discrimination and pogroms and so on, but there also were stages of enormous liberation, liberal policies and development and so on. And one of the great, great eras of the Jewish population in Prague took place in the late 1500s. Today, the Jewish quarter is very, very popular as a tourist destination because so much of it survives. There are a number of synagogues which all architecturally, all as a building, survive, and the functioning one today is the Old New Synagogue, which in fact claims to be the oldest synagogue in Europe. It's a fascinating Gothic building, and of course it originally was the New Synagogue, and then of course other synagogues were built, so it became the Old New Synagogue. You know? And so it is, as you see today, survive with, next to it is the Jewish Town Hall, for the district, and it is almost exactly the same now in the sunlight as in that rather grimy old photograph taken a good 100 years ago, if not more. And nothing has changed. This is the irony of it all, because in any other city that the Nazis captured, in Poland or Lithuania or wherever, immediately the Jewish synagogues and civic buildings would be demolished to obliterate them. But when they demolished them, they kept the treasure. And their intention was that Prague, if the Reich had succeeded, the Prague was going to be one of its great sort of showpieces. And so they were keeping all these Jewish buildings in Prague so that then they were going to create a museum of the people that they'd eliminated. I mean, you know, can you imagine the mindset of these people? Unbelievable. Anyway, that's why they survive, and that's why the Jewish quarter is so interesting. And as I say, there were moments in its history where there were very liberal and sort of free air times. And one of them was the era of the Rabbi Lof. Rabbi Lof was, as you see, late sort of mid-1500s to the early 1600s. He was known as the sort of leader, the sort of inspiration of Prague, the Maharal of Prague. And although he was born actually in Poland, but he then became a rabbi in Moravia, and then head of the Jewish, spiritual leader of the Jewish community in Prague. And what is so extraordinary is that, in fact, he was given at the time, it was the time of Rudolf II, who we'll discuss later. Rudolf II was a very strange man, but he was a very liberal man. He allowed tolerance of all religions and faiths. There was no discrimination. And he gave an audience to Rabbi Lof. I mean, emperors don't give audiences to the common man, ordinary people. But Rabbi Lof was such a great intellect, he was such a great leader, that he even was given an audience by Rudolf II. The statue I find absolutely fascinating. It's a weird statue, but I think it's a rather lovely one. It's again by this man, Ladislav Shaloun, who is sort of in the mold of the Art Nouveau, really. But again, this huge figure sort of looming up before you, like a sort of vision almost. And it's very symbolic, because people always remark on the fact that there's this great Jewish leader and seer, a man of great upstanding and worth and so on, and there against his side is leaning a nude girl who is holding a rose in her hand. And the rose supposedly is poisoned. I mean, it's temptation, basically. And so he's holding up his hand. You can see that in the detail there. He's saying, no, go away, you know. I think it's a little far-fetched, the symbolism, but I think it's a lovely statue, wonderful statue of him standing in what again is the Jewish quarter, but this is a new area of the Jewish quarter, the new town hall. So there in the grave, in the cemetery, which is within the Jewish quarter, is a cemetery which, in fact, was ceased to be a burial ground in the 18th century, but previously through the centuries before, it was quite small, a plot about the size of this room, and so therefore layer upon layer of people have been buried, and so one layer would be earthed over, and another layer will be put on top through the centuries. It's all rather higgledy-piggledy and very, very sort of picturesque looking today. And of course, the most famous tombstone, because there are no tombstones after 1787, the most famous tombstone is of Rabbi Lof. And you can see there that people, if you look at the right-hand illustration, they're little stones, people who put stones in the, for prayers, for respect, and so on. And there, in the middle, is the lion. His name was Judah Lof, the Lion of Judah. But again, it's the Lion of Bohemia as well. So it's got that double meaning. And I'll just... Then I thought I'd play you what is the prayer or hymn called Mattuvu. This is in an adaptation by a man called Lewandowski, and it's sung by the excuse me, the choir of the University of Illinois.
Thank you.
Right, so we'll just end here. I want to show you the Charles Bridge again. They were both taken. I went to Prague specifically to try and get the feeling of the town in this last June, July. And so this photograph at the top was taken on June evening, and the one at the bottom was taken on July, hot July morning. And you can see there, both of them, the Charles Bridge, one looking towards the old town at the top, one looking towards the St Vitus at the bottom. So with that, I suggest we have a break. And by that clock, I'll start at 10 minutes past four. Yes, 10 minutes past four. Ladies and gentlemen, right, it's now after 10 past, or just coming past 10 past, so I'm beginning. And we will move on to lecture two. And you see there a view of Prague. The castle is on the top left-hand side, the lesser town descending below it, and we are first of all going to go to the castle, just sort of approximately where the bell tower stands. Opposite that is a very magnificent building, a very magnificent hall, a wonderful space. It's called the Vladislav Hall, and it is a really one-off thing. Now, look at the date. It's the late 15th century, late 1400s, and it is a feat of engineering apart from anything else, because it's got this enormous span, and I don't think anywhere in sort of say France or certainly England would have been capable of doing this. So obviously the engineer must have been, or the mason must have been very, very good. And it's also fascinating historically and architecturally, because again the date is the late 1400s, 1490s. It's the same date as King's College Chapel, Cambridge. And they both have this late Gothic decoration. It's not the same decoration. The fan vaulting in Cambridge is supreme, but it's the last expression of the Gothic world. And this is a building which is transitional. The vaulting is purely imaginary, purely decorative. There's no structural basis of it at all. And it just sort of swirls around in great sort of loops all down the room, which makes it very attractive. But it's, and you can see that if you look there, it just sort of ends in nowhere. So there's no structural element at all. So it's a late Gothic expression in a building which actually is much, much more classically inspired. The windows are big. They're the original windows. And on the outside of them, you actually find the classical pilasters. So it's one of the earliest buildings north of the Alps, in fact, which actually shows classical influences coming out of Renaissance Italy. And so it's a building of a room of quite significance. It still is a room that is used for all big functions. Well, I've been there sometimes when the room is filled with chairs, where there's been some meeting, and the president has been distributing honors or whatever. And so it's a room that is still very much a functional structure, not just a tourist attraction. And it's called the Vladislav Hall. It's named after the king of the time, who was obviously King Vladislav. Excuse me. And so there is the king. He's looking a bit bemused, I think. He doesn't look terribly happy. Now, King Vladislav, who wore two crowns, he was the King of Bohemia and King of Hungary, obviously, although he looks a bit sort of bit of a spent force. He obviously had quite some drive within him, and he organizes a double marriage. He organizes a marriage for his son, who's on the left-hand side, and his daughter, who's on the far right-hand side. And they both marry into the Habsburg family. And so his son, who is Louis II, who becomes Louis II, he marries Mary of Austria, a Habsburg girl. She's the granddaughter of the Emperor Maximilian I. His daughter, Anne, on the right-hand side, marries Ferdinand I, who becomes the Holy Roman Emperor. And so all would have gone smoothly, and Louis II, as a successor to his father, Vladislav, would have become the king of Bohemia and Hungary, what he does for a period of time. But he's then killed. He's killed in battle. So his titles pass, because his father's dead, of course, his titles pass to his sister, because she's the only surviving relative. So she cannot become the queen, the king of Bohemia and Hungary. She can't, as a woman, inherit a crown. So she hands them to her husband, Ferdinand. You know, rather than it's used to hand a sort of chicken to somebody, you know. And she hands these two crowns to her husband, who's already the Holy Roman Emperor in Vienna. And he then also, overnight, becomes the King of Bohemia and the King of Hungary. And that is the moment when it was obviously wasn't intended, because it was a dynastic marriage, but it was obviously the intention was that for Vladislav II, that his son would succeed, and so would his progeny after that. But instead of which, the Habsburgs suddenly, overnight, inherit two kingdoms, the Kingdom of Bohemia and the Kingdom of Hungary. And that's when, as I say, the Habsburgs take power, and that the date is 1526, and they will continue in power, and they'll continue to dominate the Czechs until 1918. It's a long time. Vienna will always be the center of attraction. It'll always be the power behind the center of power. Prague will always be a provincial capital, always on the side of affairs. And Vienna will always be the sort of draw, the magnet, for anyone who wishes to get on in life. Same as any empire, really. So that is the moment when the Habsburgs become the dominant force. Now, in the cathedral, and you can see that is the chancel. In the center of the central nave is a tomb. You can't actually get to it now because you're shunted round the side aisles as a visitor, as a tourist. You can't get into the center. Obviously, you go to a service, you can. But normally, you can't get close to this tomb. Not for no particular reason, it just happens to be where it is. But it is a most magnificent tomb. And as you can see, from the lower inscription, lower writing. It was actually carved in Innsbruck, but carved by a Flemish sculptor. Once the Habsburgs come to power in Prague, you'll find that a lot of craftsmen come from the Low Countries, from what is now Belgium and the Netherlands. Because as you probably know, at this time, the Habsburgs ruling in Vienna actually owned Belgium and the Netherlands, rather like you own a sort of Mercedes-Benz or something, you know, you own the Netherlands. And so the sculptor was a man from Flanders, Colin, and it's a beautiful, beautiful piece of Renaissance sculpture. In the center is Ferdinand I, whose wife kindly gave him the crowns of Bohemia and Hungary. There she is on the right-hand side of the illustration. She's got rather portly, as you can see. It, by the way, was a love match. Although it was an arranged marriage, it was a very happy marriage. Unusual, but it was. For arranged marriages. Then on the other side, on the left-hand side, is their son Maximilian. He becomes the emperor in Vienna. He then is also the king of Bohemia. He's also the king of Hungary. Maximilian II. His son, who will be the third Habsburg, who becomes the king of Bohemia, we're not interested in the other things. The third king of Bohemia, who is a Habsburg, is Rudolf II. He's the grandson of Ferdinand, the son of Maximilian. He's a strange man. The Habsburgs The Habsburgs in history were generally brilliant politicians. They were generally clever. They were generally great artistic patrons. Not all, but generally. And they pass on these genes because they all they always marry relations. They always marry cousins. So they'll always just be the same gene pool passing through the centuries. And there was also a mad gene that popped up occasionally. And I think Rudolf rather got that one. He was born in Vienna. He was a very clever man. He was a very far-sighted man. But he was a peculiar. He had a very strange streak. He was introspective. Sometimes for years on end, he wouldn't show himself to the people. He'd just live in his... He came to Prague. As you can see, he was brought up in Spain. Perhaps that's one of the reasons why he was so peculiar. But I don't mean Spain as a country as peculiar. The court of Philip II was peculiar. And then he succeeds his father as the king of Bohemia, blah, blah, blah. And he then moves his court to Prague. Now, that's strange because Charles IV, we've seen, but Charles IV was two centuries before, but Rudolf wasn't born in Prague, but it's thought that maybe he just didn't like Vienna. I mean, he was, as I say, an idiosyncratic man. So he moves his court to Prague, which means that then it becomes the center of the empire. It means that then he will summon all these craftsmen to Prague, because the one thing he was good at was that he was a brilliant art patron. In fact, he's arguably, and it's now increasingly argued, that he is probably the greatest art patron the Western world has ever known. But it was all for himself. He lived in those big, big buildings we've seen surrounding the St Vitus, all on his own. He never married. He lived in there with room after room after room, hundreds of rooms, filled with treasure that nobody saw, just himself. He was... Well, peculiar. And he then cedes control because he didn't have any interest in politics. He cedes control to his brother Matthias and then dies after having been stripped of all his powers. He was known, some people regard him, some historians, which it's arguable that he was an ineffectual ruler, which he was, and his mistakes led to the 30 Years' War. But on the other hand, people call him a great and influential patron of the arts, which is true. And he also was a devotee of science and learning generally. He's the emperor who actually gives an audience to the rabbi. So he's a multifaceted character, but a very strange one at that. But his collection of art was absolutely amazing. Most of the Bruegels in the world today were owned by him. Most of the Durers in the world were owned by him at the time. You can go on. It's quite extraordinary. And he also summoned to Prague all these artists and craftsmen. As the emperor, you don't refuse. If you're told, if the emperor wants you, you go. And so he summoned all the greatest craftsmen. And you can see that this is one of the many people he summoned to Prague. He was an engraver from Germany, Joris Hufnagel. And there you can see what the castle district looked like then. There's the bell tower. There is the chancel of St. Vitus, built by Charles IV, two centuries before this. There are all the buildings surrounding the cathedral. And it was in those that he lived, in those that he filled, these rooms after rooms after rooms with great treasures. You can see again on the bottom illustration, it's part of the same page, but there you can see the castle now is on the right-hand side. The lesser town is below. Charles Bridge crosses the river, and that is the old town there. You can see the steeples, the two towers of the tin church there. It brings us into focus, because now you see this is late 15, early 1600s. So we're getting into more of the modern era. We're getting into more an era that we can understand quite more easily. And so, for instance, he employed a man called Spranger. Spranger came from Brussels. Again, part of the Habsburg territory. And these were painted solely for Rudolf's own personal enjoyment. They're really soft porn. And well, it's actually quite hard, I think, the one on the right-hand side. I mean, really, look at Minerva there. She's wearing a very fetching, very, very revealing piece of armor, I feel, and with her foot on a man's neck. A good bit of S&M, really. And interestingly, these are all in Vienna today, because what happens is that these rooms and rooms and rooms and rooms were filled with these treasures. And when he eventually cedes control and eventually has to abdicate, his brother Matthias moves back to Vienna and takes a lot of the treasure with him. Thank goodness, because now that is the art gallery in Vienna, the famous art gallery called the Kunsthistorisches Museum, KHM, Kunsthistorisches Museum. That is, without Rudolph's collection, it would be a very small gallery. It is filled to, by a lot of Rudolph's paintings. And these are in Vienna, with many others by Sprunger. And you know, up until about 1950, they were never displayed, because the galleries themselves, the director of the KHM, actually thought they were too suggestive for anybody to see. Nowadays, anything goes, of course. So, I mean, these are just rather boring. But that was one of Rudolph's tastes. We don't know. He never married. I think he was probably bisexual. I don't think he was gay. But I think he obviously enjoyed feminine beauty, because these are painted for him, heaven's life. I mean, he wouldn't have otherwise ordered them. Another example, I can go through many. There was a famous Dutch sculptor called Adriaan de Vries, who worked for him, creating some of the most amazing pieces of bronze work. And galleries today, they're mainly in Sweden and in Vienna. But here's a man called Mizaroni. Mizaroni was a stone cutter of absolute genius. These are all solid pieces. And the top one, for instance, on the left is a jasper jug, a solid piece of jasper, which is now carved in this quite exquisite form into a jug shape. And then the mounts are by a Dutch artist, Paulus van Vianen. There's a cameo. That's a heliotrope vase. They're sort of difficult to get an idea of the size, but they're smallish. They're sort of 6 inches, 9 inches. They're not much bigger than that. But they're that heliotrope vase, again, with that incredible gold filigree work on the lid. An agate bowl, a jasper bowl, and all with these mounts by Jan Vermeijen. And as I say, you know, he brings all, like a sort of compulsion. He was compulsive. He collected more and more and more and more, all of the very best. It was interestingly, sorry, I'll just go back, I've gone now. But, and then Vermeijen himself, is the jeweler who comes again from the Netherlands. And Jan Vermeijen is one of the supreme names in jewelry work in the world, working at this time for Rudolph in the early 1600s. And he creates for Rudolph this crown, which then becomes the crown in the 19th century, early 19th century, the imperial crown of Austria. It survives today in the treasury in Vienna. And as I say, it's fortunate they were taken back to Vienna, because otherwise they would have probably been lost during the 30 Years' War. The crown is symbolic, that it represents the combination of the temporal power, you crown yourself, or you're crowned by this object, and also it represents the ecclesiastical power. It's in the shape of a mitre. These are 3-4 sections giving the shape of a mitre. And this incredible enamel work, the pearls, the enamels, the diamonds. There's one sapphire, but it's quite a substantial one at the top there. It is one of the amazing works of art. All this was created for this strange, strange man. But he gave Prague a liberality. He in fact, provided the freedom for the people. He was an extraordinary man, Rudolph, and I think he's been rather maligned in history, and perhaps he's being more reconsidered now. Now, just behind the Cathedral of St. Vitus, there is this little street called the Golden Lane, because it's still talked about, and it still is mentioned, which is wrong, that in fact it was where these craftsmen lived and worked, which is not true, but it is very, very, very picturesque. It's probably where the guard who protected Rudolph, his castle guard, would have lived. Today, of course, it's very much a tourist attraction, it is, these are all little souvenir shops and so on as you walk down it. The Golden Lane, which is constructed in the late 1500s at the time of Rudolph, and there's a higgledy-piggledy quality about it, which is rather pleasant. Now, Rudolph is deposed, his brother Matthias moves back to Vienna, taking with him the the best sections of the collection, which is now in Vienna, as I say. Now, the Czechs at this stage feel that they've been isolated again, and what happens is that, in fact, they exercise their authority when two representatives from Vienna come to the Vladislav Hall, which I've just shown you. Adjacent to the Vladislav Hall, there's a series of little rooms. And it was from one of those little rooms adjacent to the Vladislav Hall that the Czech people, the Czech nobility, who were largely supporting the Hussites, the Protestants, felt that, you know, enough was enough. They were fed up with being told what to do by Vienna. So they picked up these two men. One was called Slavata, the other one was called Martinich, and they also had their secretary with them. And they picked up these three men and threw them out of the window. The window was on the second floor. And they all survived. Which wasn't the intention. The Catholics think that they were caught by angels. The Protestants think they fell on a dung heap, but one or the other way, they survived. And you can sort of understand the motive or the reasoning behind it, the fact that the Czech nobility just had enough of these people telling them what to do. But it was a rather silly act, because this is the spark that unites, that ignites the 30 Years' War. And this was the terrible, terrible war which swept all over Central Europe for 30 years, and it was the war between the Protestants and the Catholics. And people fought on, you know, each side. The Swedes come in to fight for the Protestant side, and other people come in and fight for the Catholic side. And it goes on and on and on. Cities are destroyed, people are hanged, and it goes on and on and on. And so they eventually fight themselves out. And the war ends in 1648. So it's a very bleak period for the whole of Central Europe, and a very bleak period for Prague. And after the end of the war, in 1648, obviously it takes you 10 years, 20 years to recoup, and villages to be rebuilt and people to settle down again, crops to be grown. But by the time you get to the 1660s, 1670s, things begin to revive, but it's very much the Catholics are supreme. The Habsburgs, although they have won the day, there's no longer any protest from the Czech citizens. They're suppressed. Catholicism is imposed in Prague, and it's a time when, of course, the Catholic Church is triumphant. And they build these amazing buildings, and Prague, of any city, has more Baroque buildings than any other city on earth. They have every church, these amazing churches, filled with treasures, filled with altarpieces, all designed in the most elaborate, ornamental manner, are one of the glories of Prague. And they're all these Catholic churches, and some Catholic palaces as well. But because the aristocracy was largely associated with the Catholic side. So one of the products of this was that when the Catholic Church is triumphant, and they wish to reassert their power, they wish to bring back the faithful who have been attracted by Protestantism, they create this series of counter-reformation saints. They're countering the Reformation. And the counter-reformation saints are not only from Prague, they're from Spain, from France, from elsewhere. They're usually sort of modernish people. They're not going way back into the very early periods of Christianity. And one of the people they choose as a counter-reformation saint to ignite the enthusiasm in the people is somebody who actually died 300 years before. His name was St. John of Nepomuk. He is born in a town called Pomuk in Bohemia, and they put an N-E in front, St. John of Nepomuk. Obviously, he was a man again of the church. He was a man of great distinction, and he then is thrown to his death into the Vltava River. But this all takes place in the 1300s. We're now talking about the 1600s. He's thrown to his death into the Vltava because the king of the time, whose name was Wenceslas IV, thought that the the theory, the story is that Wenceslas IV threw him into the river because he wouldn't reveal the secrets of his wife's confession, the queen's confession. But that's actually not true. The reason was that Wenceslas and St. John Nepomuk, or John Nepomuk then, were at daggers drawn because Wenceslas was trying to interfere with the church. And so, anyway, he was thrown to his death. And he's buried in the cathedral of St. Vitus. But he would be a little asterisk, he would be a little rubric, he would be a little sort of footnote in history if it wasn't for the fact that then they needed a saint in Czechoslovakia, or in the Czech lands. They needed a saint to counter the Protestants. And they build him up into this wonderful, big, marvelous figure who's martyred and everything else goes on, so on and so forth. And he's the first statue to be placed on the bridge. It's the only bronze statue, the others are all of stone, and it shows him there as the saint with his characteristic symbols. He always wears a halo with five stars. He holds in his hand the cross of Christ with Christ upon the cross. Churches are built in his name all over the Czech lands, all over Bavaria, all over Austria. And it's this huge revival that gives him sort of superstar status, basically. And he still is a very significant figure, as a counterpart, as I say, to the Hussites on the other side. And what is so amazing is that he was buried in a nice, simple little grave with a little name on it in the cathedral. Now that he's become a superstar, he's made into a superstar, he has this enormous tomb. It's all of solid silver. And it is... It's incredible. It's the epitome of the Baroque. It's grand. It's theatric. It's ornamental. It's in movement. It has all the sort of decorative elements of the Baroque. And there is the saint above kneeling on his casket. There are the angels at his sides, great figures holding candles, sticks, and so on and so forth. It's this enormous sort of like an explosion of decoration, and it's designed at this time, now in the early 18th century, by the great architect and designer of Vienna, J.B. Fischer von Erlach. And this is very much the epitome of the era. And this is the time, as I say, church after church in Prague has this, not quite as grand as this, but it has these amazing interiors. And we'll see one in a moment. But there, first of all, let's look at the Lobkowitz Palace. The Lobkowitz were of this very, very important family. They were regarded as the Spanish faction. If you were supporting the Spanish faction, it meant you were supporting the Catholic side of the debate and the war. And they since the fall of communism, the present owner, the present descendant from the Prince Lobkowitzes has actually got his home back. He's got most of his treasures back. He's got a number of his country residences back as well. And so it's quite an achievement since 1990 to have done that. And today, it's a fascinating place to visit, with treasures beyond belief, dinner services of porcelain, of pottery, of Delftware, paintings, marvelous paintings. And I just want to show you two paintings from the Lobkowitz collection. this is a Bruegel. It was originally a series of six. And this is Peter Bruegel the Elder, the great Bruegel, because there are lots of other sons and nephews and so on who followed in this man's footsteps. And Bruegel speaks to all of us still today. He's got that common touch. He creates a world which we can understand. It's an imaginary setting. Bruegel worked in Belgium, modern Belgium, and Belgium doesn't have mountains like that. But it's the actual scene, because there were six paintings, so each painting represents 2 months of the year. This represents June and July, haymaking. There's a great cart carrying the hay, being loaded with hay in the background. And there in the foreground, this joyous representation of these three girls striding across the picture plane, and they are real, they're human. This is why we relate to them. This is why still today hospital wards or various institutions have Bruegel paintings, because we still admire them. They still have a relevance somehow. They speak to us down the centuries. And this is probably not the greatest, but it certainly is one of the most important of that six. One has disappeared. Five survive. Three are in the museum in Vienna, the Kunsthistorisches Museum. One is in the Metropolitan Museum in New York, and this one is back in Prague in the Lobkowitz collection, or in Prague. And similarly here, this was purchased by one of the Prince Lobkowitzes in the mid-18th century. He was a young man, he was a sixth prince, and he came, by then, I mean, the Lobkowitzes were hugely powerful and very, very wealthy. And he came, in fact, to London to buy horses to enhance his stud, and which he probably did. But he also obviously had an eye, an artistic eye, and was a very cultured man, and he bought two paintings by Canaletto. Canaletto, if you remember, lived and worked in London rather than Venice for about 10 years. He lived and worked from about 1746 to about 1756. Not continuously, but he was there for many of those years. And supplying the public who bought his paintings, because the majority of his patrons were British. And so in London, Prince Lobkowitz buys this painting with a companion. They're big. They're very big for Canaletto. And they are both of the Thames. And this is this quite amazing piece of his history, really, that there is the Lord Mayor in his barge processing down the Thames on the day of his election to be Lord Mayor of the City of London. There in the City of London, you see all the steeples of the Wren churches, with, of course, St. Paul's dominating the skyline. And it's a wonderful record, and is, again, one of these supreme paintings, together with its companion, the pendant, which are in the Lobkowitz collection. But the most important item, almost unbelievable to contemplate, actually, is that the Lobkowitz collection, which you can see, and this is on display, they own the original score of Beethoven's Third Symphony, the Eroica. And the original score is dedicated to the seventh Prince Lobkowitz. You can see there, you may not make it out, but it says Dedicata, and then in Italian it says to His Most Serene Highness, the Prince Lobkowitz, spelt in German, the German way. And the reason behind this, which you may know, or may have heard of, may ring a bell, is that originally Beethoven intended to call this symphony the Bonaparte, in honor of Napoleon, because Napoleon was highly regarded by many intellects and liberal people in Europe. And this veneration of Napoleon by Beethoven and many others was shattered when Napoleon crowned himself emperor, because he was then just trying to be like any old ruler again, you know, dominating power and sort of building big houses with swimming pools and so on. When that happened, he then says that this is composed to celebrate the memory of a great man, whether that is Prince Lobkowitz or whether it is Napoleon, we don't know. But it clearly says dedicated to His Most Serene Highness Prince Lobkowitz. And Prince Lobkowitz, actually, the one we're talking about, the seventh prince, was a very great patron of Beethoven anyway. He used to pay him a stipend, a sort of a monthly check would come along for Beethoven's upkeep. So, I mean, he was a great patron of the arts. But it is quite something to have this there. And also to feel the present owner of the collection, direct descendant from this man, must be pretty chuffed to think that, gosh, one of the most famous pieces of music in the world was dedicated to one of my ancestors. I mean, it's quite sort of weird in a way. And so I thought we'd just break for a moment, and you'll hear just a tiny bit of the Eroica. It's the second movement, which is the fast movement. And this, I think, I pinch all these clips off the internet. Well, I don't pinch. I'm allowed to do it because this is an educational a series. But it is. And I think these background photographs must have been made in Canada, because you see sort of lakes, and then you see a grizzly bear, and then suddenly you see a Namaqualand daisy, which is a bit sort of confusing. But anyway, you can listen for a moment to the Eroica. we'll come back. I could play it all, but we'd be here all afternoon. So then back to the castle district and to the Archbishop's Palace, which is on the top left-hand side. And this is Castle Square you're looking at, with the cathedral behind. And again, in the castle district, there's this vast series of monasteries and churches and so on, which all date from this Baroque period, this period of about 1660 on through into about 1760. And as I say, the multiplicity of them is just staggering, because no other city in the world has such. There's the entrance gateway on the top slide on the right-hand bottom is the details below of these two titans, these two huge figures, again by one of these Baroque sculptors. Great movement, great drama, great theatrical sense about it all. And then the gate entrance gate behind. And you see that same, you see the same statues in various dates. 1939, with the Nazis on their motorcycles driving past. 1989, I took this photograph in the middle when I was there for the Prague Music Festival in May 1989. I had two lovely ladies from Cape Town on that tour, with amongst others. And do you know, you can see there, that was May. Prague is packed to capacity for the music festival, and there wasn't one person in sight. And then, a few months later, the communists fell, the wall fell down, and look at what happens in 1999. There is all the world and his wife of a morning watching the changing of the guard. Don't bother. But it's very depressing, very boring. But anyway, it's quite extraordinary that the crowds in Prague now are pretty dense. So there again is the cathedral, St Vitus, and there's the Lesser Town with the dome and the bell tower of St. Nicholas in the Lesser Town. It's one of the great Baroque buildings in the world. It uses drama, it uses theatre, it uses sort of the whole sense of movement in the building. And although you can't see it probably in detail, the church is actually in the bottom, in the middle, and the whole facade is rippling. It moves, it's almost like as if it's molded out of plasticine. It's got ripples and movement to it. Although it must be strong, the Baroque must have strength to have the drama that it says necessary. But it has this incredible sort of movement on the facade. And inside, you go into this rippling interior, painted, ornamented, sculpted to quite the most extraordinary degree. And there you can see the interior. It is one of the great churches of its type in the world. You need to pay to go in now, which is all well and good, actually. It keeps the majority of people out. But no, otherwise you just wander in, you know, people wander in, stucking ice creams or something. But there, you pay a modest sum. I can't remember now what it is, but it's not very much. And you can see there the sense of the ceiling, which is obviously showing the apotheosis of St. Nicholas. And there you can see the ceiling ripples round as reflecting the rippling of the aisles as they lead up to the main altar. And you again can see that here in what is the high altar, which is St. Nicholas himself. St. Nicholas is Santa Claus, of course, as you know. There he's placing buns on a tray, which is being held up by a putti. And he's got a bun. It looks as if he's got spikes to it, but those spikes are real because they're to keep the pigeons from landing on it. There is the third bun he's placing on the tray, because he always gives presents to people, as you know. So that's why there's St. Nicholas. But again, the whole sense of it's got this wonderful decorative ornamentation. The angels, the putti, the huge statue itself is in the sort of dramatic, light-filled environment of the Baroque, which is so typical of the essence of the style. And it's a late work, but it is a very great work. The architect and concerned, not the sculptor. The sculptor, again, is this man Plutzer, but the interior is designed by a man called Dietzenhofer, who was born in Prague, but in fact he was born of German parentage. But then by the 1780s, and this is European-wide, you see the revival of what is the classical style. Well, the Baroque is classical, but it uses it for its own dramatic purposes. You revert back to this plain simplicity of what is termed neoclassicism. And here, a very good example of that is a little theater in the center of Prague, which survives as it was built in the 1780s. It's one of these miraculous, and not the only example in Europe, but it's one of these miraculous examples of a theatre, small, of course, comparatively, which survives intact. And it's designed for a man called Nostich. You can see there Count Franz Anton Nostich Rinek. And it's sometimes referred to as the Nostich Theatre, but generally now it's called the Estates Theatre, E-S-T-A-T-E-S. And it's famous for the fact that, of course, in this theatre, Unchanged was performed the first performance of Don Giovanni by Mozart. Mozart always liked Prague. He always felt the citizens of Prague were much more welcoming, much more friendly than his own Viennese citizens, or his own Austrian citizens. And he actually visited Prague on a number of occasions. And you can see the interior here. And I remember once it was on that music tour in May 1989, we went on a tour of the stage and the interior of the theatre, of the Estates Theatre. And we had a lovely gentleman who took us round. And don't forget, this was still under communism. We didn't know then that communism was going to fall in 6 months' time. And he had a lovely twinkle in his eye, and he said, you know, there was discussion about what colour we should restore the seats to, and what colour we should use in the theatre, because mainly, like Covent Garden in London, you use red. And he said the discussion was whether what colour we should use. Should it be royal blue? Should it be whatever? And nobody, because they were all Czechs, of course, nobody wanted red, because red equals Stalin and communism. So they chose green instead. So that's why it's green today, the interior. It's a lovely, lovely environment. And as I say, the premiere of John Giovanni was performed here in the 29th of October, 1787. And then in addition, in the same theater was a musical by a man called Till, which I don't think he's died without trace. But amongst this performance was an aria called Where Is My Country, which I shall play you at the end. It's the Czech national anthem, but originally performed in a musical production in 1834. So I'm going to play, I don't know if I've got the time to play the whole thing, but I might, just about, but play the overture to Don Giovanni. And it's filmed in this theatre, so you're hearing the Mozart Don Giovanni where it was originally performed. And do you know that apparently it's a bit apocryphal, but I think it's based on fact that right up to the very moment that the curtains opened, that Mozart was still working on this overture. He was so unreliable. So, ladies and gentlemen, I think we've got to move on because we've got still to talk about another of the great periods of Prague's history, because generally, as I mentioned, the churches in Prague of the Baroque era give it a reputation of being the great Baroque city, but we've seen already that there's a lot before that of great significance. And then there is, again, increasingly recognized since the fall of communism, the Art Nouveau period in Prague is quite supreme. And the great exponent of that is the Czech man, Alphonse Mucha. And I just want to sort of emphasize that Mucha, M-U-C-H-A, has absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with Edvard Munch, M-U-N-C-H. Munch is Norwegian, and Munch paints the famous painting of the Scream. Munch is tortured, Munch is agonized, Munch is very provocative. Alphonse Mucha was totally, utterly different. He was a ladies' man, he was a man of the town, he was hugely successful. He actually is one of the creators of the Art Nouveau, and he was born and bred in the Czech Republic. He was born, as you see, in Moravia, in a small village, but he then goes to Brno, which is the capital of Moravia, for his education. And then, as I mentioned, he gravitates to Vienna, because that's where the patronage is. But he also then has a bit of a lucky break. Is paid by a nobleman to go and train in the Academy of Fine Arts in Munich. But finally, which was quite usual at the time, they were talking about the late 1880s, 1890s, he goes to Paris, because Paris is where everything was at then. It was the sort of place to go, the in place. And in Paris, he earns a living, and by then he's a working chap, and he earns a living producing magazines and advertising illustrations. Excuse me. And then his lucky break occurs, which is something that any person in the creative field hopes for. That the story is, and I think it became more elaborate and more sort of dramatic as the years went by, but the story is that he went into one of these shops that where he was producing designs, and the shop was in chaos because the great actress of the moment, who was Sarah Bernhardt, and she was the superstar of the time. She had demanded a poster for her latest production, and they hadn't got one ready. And so apparently Mucha stepped into the breach and produced what you see there on the left-hand side. And whether that was entirely true or not, we don't know, but it was, I think there's an element of truth in it. And so therefore, rising from a sort of modest level where he's plodding away, designing a few things and so on, he suddenly hits stardom. And he never looks back. He makes an enormous amount of money out of his designs, out of his illustrations, out of his advertisements and so on. And he really is one of the initiators of this movement where you have the emphasis on the feminine form, the emphasis on curvaceousness, the emphasis on floral decoration, all parts and parcel of the Art Nouveau movement. And that is 1890s, 1910. That's basically when it begins and ends. And there he's seated in front of the poster that makes his name. Now, the posters you see would have been plastered on those kiosks. You must know the kiosks in Paris, always painted by the Impressionists and so on. These kiosks where you plaster things on them. You can put a death notice on it. You can put an advertisement for a coffee bar or something. But he designed a poster that was long and thin, which went the entire length of the kiosk, which, I mean, seems an ordinary idea, but it was actually unique at the time. And the poster was an instant success. The whole of Paris talked about it. It was new, it was exciting, it was pretty, it was ornamental. And there you can see him seated in front of the original in his studio. So then he works, because Sarah Bernhardt was so thrilled with this, and she commanded. She was a great superstar, as I say. And then she employs Mucha as her own designer for some years to come. And I don't know why that's jumped. I should have gone back one. Oh, I haven't included. So then he designs posters for Sarah Bernhardt. But then he branches out And here, one of many, you could get the 12 months of the year or whatever. Always the feminine form, always these pretty faces, always showing quite a degree of flesh, which of course was something which was so exciting at the time. If you think that only one generation before piano legs weren't allowed to be revealed in case they evoked thoughts in the minds of men. And so now you have really quite seductive illustrations, and they were hugely successful. All shapes and sizes, all the themes that he designed. This is one of his most popular, the four times of the day, a morning awakening, the brightness of day, evening reverie, a night's rest, and so on and so forth. And then, of course, he still continued and to make money and to create great success out of his advertisements. And there you then also his greatest work, though, was back in Prague, in the Municipal House. It's such a boring name, Municipal House, but actually it's the most significant building. It's the most wonderful building. It's probably the most famous Art Nouveau building in the world. It's designed by two architects. They were both local. And it's, I don't know whether they intended this, the authorities, or not, but apparently these two men could not stand each other. anyway, they somehow seem to work together. And what is so fascinating is that the building, like everything in Prague, survives. And that is really partly to thank, we have the communists to thank for that. Because under communism, from 47 through to 89, 1947 to 1989, nothing changed. The communists just allowed everything to sort of disintegrate, but they didn't change anything. They didn't build huge high-rise blocks. They didn't suddenly redecorate everything, as the West was doing all the time, because there was too much money around. Here they didn't have money, and they didn't do anything. So then, when communism fell, all they had to do was to restore them, just repaint them. And you can see here that what is the Municipal House, which was is a sort of municipal building. It's got a wonderful concert hall inside. And in the center is what is one of the source works of Mucha, which is the painted interior of the mayor's hall. And you can see there, he uses this rather dramatic dark blue as a background, obviously scenes from Slavic legends. He was a great Slavophile. Munch, in fact, begins to turn his back on the Art Nouveau style, which he popularized and from which he made a great deal of money. And he begins to increasingly paint sort of politicized art because he wants to promote the Slavic people, the Slavic not being only the Czechs, but all the Slovakians, the Poles, the Bulgarians, the Russians, and everyone else, all the Slavs. And so these are Slavic legends, and the ceiling above represents the Slavic unity, and then below there are these wonderful illustrations of these men in the pendentives, where you can see representing certain elements of one's character, militancy, faithfulness, strength, and vigilance, and in his work. Now, he goes to America in the early 1900s, thinking, oh, that is what the hope was, and Sarah Bernhardt went to America and made a huge success. Somehow, Mucha didn't. I don't know why. Perhaps he didn't get the right patrons. Perhaps he didn't hit the right spot. I don't know what happened, why it didn't work out as it should have. But what he does find in America is a hugely supportive man, a patron, another patron. And this man obviously had Czech or Slavic leanings, because what Mucha did was turn away from the Art Nouveau towards the end of his life, and for 10 years, from 1918 to 1928, in a great villa outside Prague, where he had space, he began to paint 20 huge paintings. You can see how big they are. There is Mucha himself, seated in front of one of them. It took him 10 years to paint these, and they all are of very obscure stories from the Slavic legends. And basically, today, one does wonder, you know, was it all worth it? You know, it's sort of an awful lot of effort for not much return, basically, I feel. But it was his intention. He was a tremendous nationalist, and he wanted to promote his own people, his own language, his own culture, which is why he did it. I think today it is slightly questioned, but he left it, the whole collection, the whole 20 paintings, to the Czech Republic, or the Czechs, and it's now in a museum which is the modern art gallery of Prague called the Villa Trzesny Palace, which is easy to get to, you just have to tram. And so the Slavic legend it occupies a lot of his later life. But at the same time after that, oh yes, first of all, the legend. And I wanted to talk to you about the fact that Mucha was involved with the legends of his Slavic people. So was the composer Dvorak. And so I'd like to play just a brief section of the Song to the Moon sung by Pretty Yende. This is by Dvorak from his opera Ruzalka. Oh, sorry, what am I doing? What am I doing? So that's just a brief song by, of the Moon by Dvorak, who also was very much inspired and was associated with the Czech nationalism. And sadly, in Mucha's case, then he in fact, in Mucha's case, in 1939, He's arrested by the Nazis because he supported the Czechs rather than the Nazi occupation of Czech Republic, and he dies thereafter, I think probably from the interrogation. So in the cathedral, which we've seen already, on the left-hand side, in the north aisle, all the stained glass in the cathedral is 20th century, and there is really one of the most amazing pieces of Art Nouveau, late Art Nouveau. He goes back to his original style to create this window, which is to do again with the early history of Prague, the early history of the Czech and the Slavic nations. And it has these wonderful colors of the Art Nouveau. There's mauves and oranges and aubergines and so on, very unlike the colours, obviously, in a medieval window, which are much more strong blues and strong reds. And it's one of the most extraordinary stained glass windows anywhere. Starting right at the top, I think, you can see, no, you can't, you start at the top with Christ, and then in the middle there, you have St. Claude Miller, that is the drawing for, that is Mucha's drawing for the window, following exactly. And then on the right-hand side, you have the little St. Wenceslas at his mother's knee, at his grandmother's knee. And then above that, you have the two saints, St. Cyril and St. Methodius, who, in fact, were the initial two figures who Christianized the Slavs. Not only, as I say, the Czechs. And in fact, St. Cyril is the man who gives his name to the Cyrillic alphabet of Russia and of Bulgaria. And there are the drawings by Mucha, and they're exactly reproduced in the window. It's the most fabulous window, designed towards the end of his life. But at this stage, I want to just end with... Oh, dear, wait a minute. I just want to see all slides, because I've got more to show. But I think I'd just like to end, because we're coming to the end of the lecture, and there's another lecture coming on at 5:30. But we've discussed the variety of people, starting with the legendary figure of Le Boucher, with St. Wenceslas, Charles IV, great architects, great figures such as Jan Hus, and the Baroque era. But the Czechs have hardly ever had their independence for them in their own right. They had a bit of their short independence when they became Czechoslovakia between the wars. And now, since 1994, they have independence for themselves. And there's a sort of story, there's a legend, as I say, the legend about everything in the Czech Republic, and there's a legend about St. Wenceslas. He is often shown riding a horse, and he's on his horse, and he originally gets up from his tomb in the cathedral that I've shown you. He gets onto his horse. He then rides down the lesser town, and on the Charles Bridge, there's a sword that appears to him. And with that sword, he writes the injustices that have been performed through the centuries on the Czech people. And you can sort of argue that at the moment, he could have done it, because they are free, they are independent, for the first time ever, really. Yet, we really don't know what will happen with that dreadful man sitting in Russia, but that's another story. But what I want to do then to end is to end with their national anthem, the anthem which was first performed in the Estates Theatre. It's not too long, and it's rather beautiful.